During World War II, Yale was a military camp, and the armed forces shifted their personnel so rapidly that it's hard to evaluate the football records. There is no doubt about Spence Mosley's 1942 team, however. Coached by Howie Odell, they wiped out the memory of some poor seasons. They played Princeton at Baker Field in New York, and a cold wind helped considerably by cutting down the Tigers' punting yardage. In the third quarter, Tim Hoops, wearing Clint Frank's old number 14, did some nifty stepping. Picked up some blocks from Taylor, Pickett, and Scoville, and went 53 yards to overcome a 6-0 deficit. Then, a few plays later, Bill Kirst went through a big hole at center. Cut to the left for 23 yards to start a 55-yard drive. Pickett piled through the same spot to add another 12. On a deep reverse to the right, Taylor carried to the 3. And Pickett followed Mosley through the middle to make the score 13-6. And to give Yale her first shot at the Big Three championship in 4 years. Next week, this chance looked very slim. Harvard led 3-0 with only 5 minutes left, and a punt into Yale territory seemed to put the game on ice for the Crimson. But on the following play, Hugh Knowlton passed to Hoops at midfield. Tim broke out of a circle of crimson jerseys to go all the way for Yale's first Big Three title since Larry Kelly. Mosley, a terrifically hard-hitting center, though he weighed only 173 pounds, joined his father, who played with Cupie Black in 1916 in the ranks of the All-Americans. As the servicemen came and went in 1944, Paul Walker emerged as an All-American, and Captain Mack Whiting's team won 7 and tied 1 for an undefeated season. Working from the Notre Dame box formation, Bill Penn did most of the passing, and Walker broke Larry Kelly's record for distance gained on pass receptions. Walker, here at left end, could run, and when necessary, drive like a fullback. It was a fine season, but Harvard and Princeton were not on the schedule, so a splendid record lost some of its glamour. Harvard was back in 1945, however, and Walker lost no time in showing them what they had been missing. He started the first drive by wrenching a pass out of a defender's hands for a 23-yard gain. Walker, now at right end, caught another for 8 yards at the Harvard 15. And put in a good block as Art Fitzgerald carried over for the first touchdown in a 26-0 victory. Veterans returning from battlefronts all over the world brought Yale a wealth of material in 1946. Fritz Barzalowskis, Bill Shuler, John Perchlick, Cottie Davison, Tex First, Dick Lynch, John Satir, Bolt Elwell. Plenty to man the two-platoon system. They were heavily favored over Harvard, but Chip Gannon, very cool under fire, did some fine passing for the Crimson. And turned in some good runs from Dick Harlow's new L formation. Harvard quickly took the lead, 14-0, and looked great doing it. No Yale or Harvard team had ever been that far behind and managed to beat the other. The Yale veterans were unimpressed. In the second quarter, Levi Jackson, at right halfback, started a drive with an off-tackle slant and followed up with a pass to Art Fitzgerald in motion to the right for the first Yale touchdown. Fitzgerald was all alone. Seven plays later, on a little impromptu razzle-dazzle, Ferd the Bull Nadherny took a screen pass, crashed ahead for 10 yards, and fumbled to Roderick for 10 more. Unplanned, but effective. Then Jackson took a pitch out from Tex first, got some fine blocking, and carried for 11 yards. And Nadherny proved his right to be called the Bull, as the line opened the barn door at the 10-yard line, and he steamed through for the score. In the third quarter, Tex first passed to Roderick, another record-breaking end. And the game wound up 27-14. In 1948, Herman Hickman added an air of solidity to the scene and took the team out to Wisconsin, presumably to be murdered. But the Yale defense was superlative, especially on passes. In the third quarter, the line gave right halfback Bobby Raines some magnificent blocking as he set up a touchdown with a 50-yard run. And Ferd the Bull showed tremendous drive as he went up the middle to score. The infallible Billy Boo, cool as ever, contributed a field goal and two tries for point, with Roger the Dodger Barksdale holding. And the idea that Easterners were effete went out the window. The final score was Yale 17, Wisconsin 7. In 1952, Jordan Olivar introduced the Deception of the Belly series. Once this even fooled a referee, who blew a play dead at the line and called back a touchdown. That year, Charlie Yeager, the manager, at 125 pounds, climaxed the season by fulfilling a lifetime ambition. Charlie scored the last point against Harvard in a 41-14 victory. In 1953, Princeton was leading 17-0 near the end of the half, when the Yale stands broke into a hair-raising roar as Ed Malloy, number 18, entered the game. A star passer, Ed had been hurt before the season, and this was his first appearance. They were a new team when they came out for the second half. Quarterback Jim Lopez did some fine running. And Yale went wild as the team overcame a 17-point deficit and went into the lead 20-17. But Royce Flippin, Princeton's brilliant tailback, went around left end to put the Tigers ahead again, 24-20. How did he ever get away? With less than a minute to play, things looked hopeless. But Princeton was forced to punt. Into the game at end came Larry Reno, a track man with no football experience, for the one play he knew, run like mad and catch a pass. Jim Lopez gets good protection, avoids a tackler, throws a long pass, complete to Reno on the Princeton 12. On the next play, Princeton guarded Reno closely. So Lopez false carded to Bob Poole, and another great victory went into the long history of Princeton Thrillers. The final score, Yale 26, Princeton 24. By the end of World War II, it was clear that problems arising from conflicting philosophies had to be solved. For years, Yale and others had been struggling to keep football in perspective as a game to be played for pleasure and for the values it can contribute to character, not as a spectacle to make money at the expense of educational objectives. For these colleges, the principle is to build teams, not buy them, and at the same time to have good, exciting football. The result, of course, was the Ivy League, which had its first full season in 1956. So the Army game in 1955 was destined to be Yale's last venture into the so-called Big Ten. And Yale bowed out with honor, saying in effect, "We're not quitting, we just think we have a better idea." The wraps were really off in this game. Aggressive line play by Captain Phil Tarasovic, Pete Fritchie, Mike Awishek, Bill Lovejoy, and Jack Embersitz smothered the cadet attack. And forced a flock of fumbles. The offense was crisp and decisive. Dean Lux passed to Paul Lopata, running a beautiful pattern to put Yale ahead in the second quarter, 7-6. Dick Witterbauer added the try for the point. In the fourth quarter, Denny McGill took a pitch out from Witterbauer and went wide to the left to start a drive from midfield. Watch Al Ward on another pitch out. Get away from three tacklers to put the ball on the 23-yard line. McGill went wide to the three. Slid through a huge hole of tackle to go over standing up and clinch it 14-12. As the team smothered Army's last play, the entire squad was jubilant. Stars of the day, the coaches named every one of the 25 men who played. A glorious finale for a long series. In the Ivy League, Yale did as well as in the golden era of yore by winning all league games and the 1956 championship. This was a spectacular team of veterans. Captain Mike Awishek, and with him in the line, Bide Thomas, Pete Fritchie, Kenny Jones, Jack Embersitz, and Paul Lopata, and backs who could strike from any part of the field, through the air, or on the ground, against Columbia with a perfect block by Lopata and fine deception on a trap play. Al Ward goes 73 yards for the first touchdown in a 33-19 win. 2 weeks later, after Dartmouth had punted to the Yale 7-yard line, Denny McGill made it look like magic as he tight-roped 93 yards down the sidelines, and the Indians succumbed 19-0. After 2 years of frustration, Princeton was the big one. and the pregame excitement broke out as it hadn't in years. Anything connected with Princeton, even a presidential candidate, took a ride. And with Chaplain Sid Lovett giving his blessing, spirit never rode higher. The game was hardly underway when Dean Laux passed from the 33-yard line to McGill, who goes 20 yards for the first touchdown. And in the second quarter, Denny, passing for the only time in his career, hit Jack Pendexter in the end zone, which made the coach very happy. The defense was equally powerful. Watch Charlie Griffith block this punt out of sight into the air. And fullback Steve Ackerman grab it for a 50-yard touchdown. The final score, Yale 42, Princeton 20. It was the same story against Harvard. Score, 42-24. In the second quarter, with Yale in white jerseys, McGill took a pitch out from Winterbauer, and with blocks from Laux, Pendexter, and Ward, climaxed his spectacular career as a fine running back with a 78-yard beauty. In the same period, Al Ward took a kickoff. And as the team peeled off to open the way, and Paul Lopata put in the final block, Ward duplicated McGill's 78 yards. What a pair of touchdown twins. What a team. In 1957, with most of the veterans gone, not much was expected. But Dick Winterbauer and Mike Cavallon proved themselves one of the greatest passing combinations in the country. Against Princeton, Mike scored all three of Yale's touchdowns, and Dick completed 14 out of 19 for 207 yards. Earl Hallis at left halfback also helped the season along with some fine runs and catches. They won the Big Three championship. And with Cavallon carrying the Crimson defense on his back, ran up a record 54-0 score against Harvard. In 1958, as if to prove the theory of equal competition, the Bulldog managed to lose all of its Ivy League games. And just 2 years after that, Yale came up with a team so good that every man could claim stardom. Kenny Wolfe, an exceptionally clever runner. Behind murderous blocking, Wolf averaged over 50 yards on kickoff returns to lead the nation in this department. Against Columbia, he went 87 yards. Quarterback Tom Singleton, all Ivy, all New England. Tom was devastating on the rollout. Here he passes to Kenny Wolf against Dartmouth. Here he runs like a shifty steam engine. Boom, the blast pen. He could also throw the long ones, like this one to Wolf against Princeton. Back Lou Mulair, a fine blocker. He could also run, as on this punt return against Penn. Bob Blanchard, Paul Ivey, all New England, a crashing fullback. Bob's most spectacular play was a 93-yard pass interception against Colgate. How about that for speed for a 210-pound fullback? The line made plays like this run by Kenny Wolfe against Penn look easy. 65 yards for a touchdown. Ben Baum, an All-American guard. Watch him smash three successive plays against Penn. The first on a kickoff. At left guard on the next, a power play. The third by knocking the ball carrier into his own backfield. Artie Will, the finest center in the league. Playing a roving center, Artie made more tackles than anyone else on the team. Here he pulls out of the line to a linebacker's position on the right side and goes to the far side of the field to make the tackle. Here, from the same position, he avoids several blockers to make it on the near side. Tackle Jim King. Always dependable. And Johnny Hutcherson, the fastest man on the squad. And Captain Mike Pyle, a 230-pound tackle. All Ivy, all New England, all East. Here, in white, on defense, Mike smashes through the right side of the Harvard line to force a fumble and make the recovery. Just a one-man gang. Nine seniors who had known the humiliation of 1958 came back to compile the best record in 51 years. No one knows the scores they might have made. They spent half the time watching the rest of the squad mop up. Fast, powerful, alert. Watch Rulie Carpenter of the second string, the Apaches, leave Princeton's Hugh Scott wondering where the ball went. For this team, Harvard was the big one. The Crimson's quarterback, Chuck Ravenel, the gambler, had flim-flammed them from freshman year on. But the first time they got the ball, they showed exactly what they meant to do about it. This is a perfect example of the inside belly play. That's Kenny Wolfe. Watch it again. The line made an impenetrable screen. Lou Mulaire put on a key block. No wonder Kenny Wolfe could run. Half the Harvard team went for Blanchard. Nevertheless, Ravenel, number 24, still limping from an injury which had sidelined him most of the season, was still dangerous. Dangerous until, on the first play of the second quarter, Johnny Hutcherson at left end snapped a pitch out. To make the gambler's gamble backfire for once. As usual, the whole squad got in. Second string, the Apaches. The third string, the Tomahawks. And the remainder, the U guys. On the offense with Bill Leckenby throwing to Connie Scheimer. And with a defense which helped explain why Harvard gained a total of minus 6 yards on the ground. This tackle by Bill Kay. This one by Kay and Jack Kickham. And this one by George Lunsdale. With Ted Hard making the recovery. In the end, it was fitting that the gallant little Ravenel should score Harvard's touchdown. And it was also fitting that a volunteer from Radcliffe should be immediately declared ineligible. Join the immortals. Camp, Corbin, Heffelfinger, Hinkey, Black, Mallory, Booth, Frank, and the rest. You can't name them all. Yale has had 81 All-Americans. The story of football has no ending. In 1928, more than 500 schools and colleges gave the Walter Camp Gate in honor of the men who created the game and established the tradition. That tradition was expressed so well by the grand old man, Stagg. Stagg said, "Yale taught me the lesson to teach youth, that every man will give forth the fullness of his best." The fullness of his best. The tradition which lifts football high, not only in the hearts of old blue, but in the eyes of new generations who start the game all over again every fall and will carry the tradition into the future.